Good afternoon, buon pomeriggio a tutti. My name is Corrado Paina and I'm the Executive Director of ICO Canada. Welcome to the first edition of Italy, a place to go. This project was developed by the Italian Chamber of Commerce of Ontario, Canada, and is supported by the Embassy of Italy to Canada, the Consulate General of Italy in Toronto, the Italian Trade Agency, the Istituto Italiano di Cultura, and the Italian National Tourist Board. This is the third lecture of the series Italy, a Place to Go, and it focuses on architecture and design. Italy is recognized as being a worldwide trendsetter and leader in this field. Today's lecture will revolve around sustainability, innovation, and digitalization, and they will give you the unique opportunity to look at breathtaking projects and designs. Today, we have the pleasure of hosting two of the outstanding representatives in this field. Mario Cucinella, founder and creative director of MCA, Mario Cucinella Architects. Maria Grazia Mattei, founder and president of MIT, Digital Culture Center. Their presentation will provide interesting insights about how the creative minds in the world of architecture and design will help reshape and rethink workplace and living spaces. But before starting the lecture, we have a video message from the designated ambassador of Italy in Canada, Andrea Ferrari, who greatly supports this lecture.
Dear friends, welcome to this virtual meeting celebrating Italian Design Day 2021, a yearly event launched in 2017 by the Italian Ministry of Foreign Affairs and International Cooperation and the Ministry of Culture to promote the key export sector of Italian industry. This year's theme, Project and Materials, New Challenges for the Sustainable Recovery of the Made in Italy, is a multidimensional and forward-looking choice. Indeed, when we all hope that the pandemic emergency is behind us, this is a very key moment of our societies, the moment to design a new future. I didn't use the term design casually. Design means planning. It means finding solutions related to what surrounds us, in other words, our environment. We need to redraft our relationship with matter, with materials, from nature to everyday objects, to our cities and our homes, where we spend the greatest part of our lives. The challenges ahead are not any more limited to indiscriminately boosting the industrial production and consumption. We must view them now through a lens of sustainability, focusing on the real needs of humanity. We need to seek smart solutions that will enable us to improve our quality of life through new, thoughtful and respectful ways of being in the world. But as we work towards this goal, we must never lose sight of some fundamental principles like beauty, balance and harmony. Those concepts have shaped the history of the world and they are the ones that eventually makes our lives more pleasant. Design has the power to put together all those ideas and to make our lives better, smarter and harmonious. And when it comes to these qualities, I'm proud to say that our country is very well prepared to lead. Enjoy today's webinar and thank you for joining us.
Ambassador Ferrari, thank you very much. Today is Italian Design Day and the Embassy of Italy in Canada celebrates this very important day for Italy. And I have to thank you very much also for your strong support for this session and for the entire project, Italy, a Place to Go. Let me give the floor to Eleonora Andretta, our moderator for these lectures. Eleonora is an interpreter, translator and instructor of English for academic purposes at George Brown College in Toronto.
Thank you, Corrado. Thanks a lot. And thank you for inviting me to moderate this amazing initiative in collaboration with Sistema Italia. This event would not be possible without the support from our sponsors, Impact Uti Group and Villa Charities. The theme of today's lecture is architecture and design. We have the pleasure of hosting architect Mario Cucinella, who is the founder of Mario Cucinella Architects. With over 20 years of professional practice, Mario Cucinella has developed a great experience in architectural design, with particular attention to the issues of sustainability and the environmental impact of buildings. In 2016, the Royal Institute of British Architects awarded him the International Fellowship. And in 2017, the American Institute of Architects gave him the prestigious Honorary Fellowship Award. Mario's lecture today is on building green futures. Enjoy the lecture.
Thank you very much for this presentation and for the invitation. And I'm starting with this, we believe in creative empathy. For me, creative empathy is some is in another way to say sustainability, you know, because creative empathy means you need to find relationship with peoples, with place. You know? So empathy is very important because you need to really build a relationship with the others. And creative, because creativity is driven by empathy, then you can find this kind of great relationship between your creativity, but find it in a place, in a specific place. And also an architecture office is not only one person. No? It's about many people working together. So we like to define the work of architects as a collective intelligence. So it's a multidisciplinary thinking. And this also because the challenge of architecture is very complex, and design buildings or master plan become more and more sophisticated, so we need to create more relationship between different disciplines. And also the evolution of the concept of sustainability is not anymore only about technology, but it's about this relationship between buildings and place. So we like the idea that maybe we need to find a new balance, you know, between the need of technology, but also the empathy with climate. So the hybrid buildings is a design a building as an architect, which find this relationship and get all the benefit for the climate and then add some technology because, of course, we want to live better than before. But it's like the evolution of cars, you know, between now we're discussing about the hybrid car. So we are not go fully electric, but we are more comfortable in this sort of a hybrid system, you know, give us always the chance to drive in any case. And building is the same. So it's a building, build a relation with the climate. In the same time, we need a little bit of technology to, you know, make our life better inside of the buildings. And also the evolution of tools. No, we architects, we design building with tools. No, well, many, many years ago was a pen and some other very simple things. Now what we call art digital is the area between the artisanal and the digital. So there are two things combining together. So this picture is showing the house we designed and built with 3D printer. No? But also the complexity of our life today and also the exploration. We need to explore our world, you know, especially this relation with nature. It means we need to research-based practice. So we need to develop research inside of our office to better understand what is around of us, but at the same time transfer this knowledge in our building. So we need to design better building for this new relation with the climate. And also this is very Italian tradition, no? To design from master plan to a very simple object, no? But what I'm looking at these two pictures is two different scales. Now, one is a piece of city in Catania. Another one is we design a set for a table. No? But the creativity is not in relation only a the dimension. No? I like design object, but also in the small things is a lot of details. You know, a lot of work needs to be done to find a solution. So I like to think in an architect is still a person who is traveling between a big scale and a very, very small scale using creativity as a tools. You know? And of course, design building is for common good. I think this is the social responsibility of an architect. When you design building for the others, not only for yourself. So and buildings remain in time and people use, and also you create a memory, you know, because this is a little school for music built in Emilia Romagna after the earthquake. You know, every cylinder is a tool, is an instrument, you know, it's a violin, it's a piano, it's a drums, and it's a guitar. So this place was not there before. Now there are students going, and then you can be the opportunity for students to be maybe tomorrow amazing singer or amazing player, but also is the responsibility to create space to give to kids or young people an opportunity. No? And that's for the reason we built 6 years ago the School of Sustainability, which is our social responsibility in front of the new generation. After almost 30 years of work, we want to give back what we know, so our knowledge, give back to the young, because the young people, like 23, 25, after the diploma, they need to facing a great challenger, the challenger of the climate change and how they can design better place for the future. So that's why we engage on this school. And also, it's not about only teaching them, you know, that is the old story of school, is an exchange between us, our experience, and also the vision of the future of the young people. So in these two exchange, I think we start to prepare the leader of tomorrow. And to talk about this, I think it's very important to know that the roadmap is very clear, you know, starting from Rio de Janeiro, 1992, the first climate change conference for UN. And now you see in time, COP21 in Paris was the first time that all government decided to take an agreement to make some change. The Pope Francis encyclical Laudato Si is a very important document to talk about the ecology, you know, and also the building poverty. It's not only poverty for financial poverty, it's not only about the poverty by food, but also buildings, you know, people living in some area in very poor buildings. So. And then you see our goal is EU 2030, no CO2 reduction, and then also the roadmap to under 2050. So you can see now the people which is now finished their school, the university, they face in next 30 years the great challenge I never had met before. So that's why our work is also in some way to help them, but in the same time starting this trip to the future, now how we can design better building for the future. And the paradox of the story is the CO2 emissions start to go up, you know, and we find an agreement on 2030, not to reducing CO2 emission until 2060, you know, to zero. At the same time, we need to build a lot of billion square meters because of the demography of the planet. So how we're going to do that will be a great, great challenge. You know, how we can reduce emission and at the same time build a lot of buildings. That is the challenge for the next generation. But if you think about how we can do zero emission building, or what we call zero impact, so how we did before. So how we did before the Industrial Revolution? What's happened before? So when there was no energy available. So we built an amazing city everywhere in the planet, you know, in the most hostile place, the most beautiful, and always find the design solutions, always find a good relation with climate, always be friend of nature. So I think the future is also maybe behind us, maybe in the history, you know, look in the history with no nostalgia, no nostalgia, no, but maybe the past can give us some information about knowledge, how we did before. So, and I want to give you a very simple example, which I'm very fascinating, no, because I'm always looking in front of us, for architects always looking for the future, no? But maybe we need to discover also what happened before, no? How people was able to design amazing cities and buildings in many, many different places. No? This was my plan last year in 2020. It was my birthday, 60 years old. And I thought to take a 6 month off, like a sabbatic period, for a travel around the world to discover these buildings, you know, and recording that knowledge and bringing back. You know? So I just give you, I was impossible to do the trip, of course, for the coronavirus problem, but I show you some of a picture, because what I'm interested in, not to design building as in the past, of course, but discovering how the architects in that time, they were so clever to find this relationship with climate. So there are many examples. I just give one is in Costozza in Treviso, no? We are in Veneto. It was a villa that was built behind a covolo, which is like a grotta. No? And from that area behind, in this cave, there was the air was cold and humid, so it's heavy, you know, and it's fall down in this cave, and then go inside the building and cool the building inside. So it's amazing stories of how buildings, you know, was able to get so amazing friendship with nature. Also, the jackal in Iran was writing by Marco Polo, you know, in 1273. He was arriving in Persia, and then they arrive in a village in the middle of the desert, and in sign of welcome, they give to him an ice cream. So how people was able to make ice in the middle of the desert in 1273. So this is fascinating, no? Because we always design buildings with empathy. So there are many stories, though. I'm not going to tell you everything, but you can easily find it in my website or in the book. But we're always fascinated by the idea that architects was always able to find the right solution in this relationship. So I'll give you some example of my work, which is built in Italy. So I built in many different places, but this is dedicated to Italy. So it's we built a nursery school in close to Modena, in the heart of Emilia Romagna. And it was inspired by the Pinocchio story. You know, this is Mr. Geppetto writing in the side of a whale, no? And Pinocchio was lost for 2 years inside of this whale. And he tried to find his father, and in the end he found it. So in the book, there's a two-page which is absolutely amazing for the emotion and the passion of the kids and his father. No? And I find this picture, for me, representing also the protection as a mother, no? Keeping that inside and safe. You know? And that was inspiring me to make this this kindergarten, no? As like they be inside the whale. It's an important place because, you know, this is a place for kids from 0 to 3 years old, which is for them is the first time to go out of a domestic place, is out of the family, the relation with their mothers and fathers. So you need to find a place for them to imagine, you know, they go a belly of the whale, you know, and they maybe start to thinking about something else, you know, and then I think that's the importance of architecture, you know, make people thinking, you know, make people thinking themselves, creating some images, you know? And it was an amazing experience. It's all in wood constructions, very safe for kids, because I must remember then. Every kids like to touch everything, but also lick everything. So the safe is one of the most important things. That's the plan, and you see the garden is designed like a bird. It's a bird from the pianura, And so the garden is another part of very important for kids, because they don't know what the season means. They don't know, they don't know the flowers. They don't know the what's happening during the year. So some area like in March is a little forest where the butterfly come out, or there's a winter flowers and the summer flowers. So it's a pedagogic garden. No? So and that is our whale in the evening. And it was a great for the community, you know, after the earthquake, built a new place. And that's showing how much contemporary architecture is important, you know, for the community. You know? I under construction this tower in the heart of Milan, which is the tower of a company called Unipol. It's the largest, second large insurance company. You know? It's in the heart of Milan, in the business district, really in the city center. And is an office building, which is all fully transparent buildings. You know? And we take some comments about the shape, you know, because the south face of the building is an empty atrium, is a 20-story high. So it's working like a climate moderator. Now in the winter time, we keep the heating and bring inside of the office. And the summertime is ventilated to take out the heating and bring back to the machine to transform the heating and cooling. So that's, of course, not enough to make a zero building, but the shape already tells you something about this relationship. No? And it's about tools like we did in the beginning. No? Is the complexity of tools now for design buildings is quite great. And also architect facing to the increase in the knowledge how to managing this tool, and also very very useful for design complexity in buildings. No? So that's the canopy in the piazza. We are in the big podium of the business center, so the business district, and the tower is the only tower touch the ground level, the zero level, and open the facade and creating a canopy, and this should be the most important piazza in the new district. No? So the auditorium is open, transparent, and the atrium, no, is a vertical garden, which is keeping humidity, also for ventilation, and also for the people inside the office watching outside, no? Watching the sculpture. No? That is the in the top is a glass house. No, I show you, and the top floor is a canteen, no, for. And you can go to see old Milan. It's an amazing place. There's no air conditioning. It's only natural ventilated, and is glass is covered of photovoltaic. So we're producing enough energy for running the public space and the light inside the building. And that's the tower on the ground level. I have a very quick video to show you, and then. Construction was very complicated because you see the area, we are in the city center, the no space. And now last week, we just finished the corona in the top, no? We finished the floor, and then you see the complexity of the structure. No? It's you see in the end is Duomo di Milano and Torre Velasca. No? And that's the tower, or at least the structure is finished last week. You know. It's a mix between technology, steel construction and concrete construction. I know in Toronto is a long tradition of concrete also because a lot of Italian construction company, you know, was in Toronto many, many years ago. So this is a commercial video by our client, but just give you a very, very quick the way the building was built. Thank you. And the last project we just finished will be open in the next week on the 6th of July is a church. It's a little church built in Calabria in the heart of the Parco del Pollino, which is an incredible and beautiful place. I was inspired by our ancestor architects, Borromini, Bernini, you know, Sant'Andrea al Quirinale, San Carlino alle Quattro Fontane. I combine in this curve of the Barocco to creating this little church. It's a chapel, no, in the middle of this small village in the middle of mountains. No, you can see that is the place. You can see the small church, the white church in the corner. It was very important for the community because it's the only new building, no, and is a reference for many people, especially for the community, no, to gathering together, no. And in a very simple, you know, is a concrete facade, which is painting with a white painting, which is transform the pollutions. Also here is not too much, but the idea is the painting is transforming the pollution in salt, so reducing the impact of pollutions. And you can see the folding of the facade is creating a shadows and line for the cross. And it's a beautiful place, you know, it's you can see all the mountains around. The winter is all snowy, so this little chapel white will be quite impressive. And also inside, this is the images of the competition. And then that's what we built. So inside, you see the colors is made by these terra colors, no, like brown colors wash and they keep in this kind of vibration. And the ceiling is a 4 meter high layers, no, which is creating a sort of a vest, you know, but it transforming the light in very diffusing light everywhere. No? Also, the work is an artist, Giuseppe Maraniello, which is design of the all the artistic elements inside the church, you know? Yeah, and that's showing that different time of the day, and so it's inspiring by our long tradition of design place for the prey, but we try to interpret it in our time, you know? And then also surprising, we find this picture of the Alba Boreale, no? I thought was the lightness of this, was it just a light, no, in the sky by the frequency of light, you know, transforming this alba in a ceiling, you know, and become something quite magic, you know. I just sorry, I will just last very quick. We're printing a house in Italy, close to Imola. No, with a company called Wasp, which is a company who make a 3D printer. So we print the first printing house in Hurth. So it was built in 250 hour. It's the largest printer never built, and to build a house with a local material. So it was a lot of work on the design, and this design was also developing with the SOS, the School of Sustainability. So matching the idea that maybe the latest technology, you know, which is very important for the progress, but in the same time using the oldest material we know for make building, which is the earth. So that is the, during the project, you know, that was the rendering the images. And then because it's made by earth, it come back. It doesn't make any damage to the landscape or to the sensible place. No? So that is the printer. It's a quick video, the last one, to showing this relation between the history and the new technology. Thank you. And that is the house finished. So after the printing, we just had the windows, the doors, the plants inside, and this is the feeling, no? And it's quite amazing because the feeling of material, I don't know, this material bring you very close to your DNA. You feel something, no? When the emotion of that material is, I was very impressed because you're feeling something. Maybe it's the noise, it's the sound, is the, you know, the smell. I don't know, there are a few things. It's a place with not hostile, no, it's not concrete, it's not metal, it's something that is maybe part of our DNA, no? And that's showing also, to come back to the beginning of the presentation, no? I mean, Italy is a great country because it can mix the latest technology but never forgot the tradition. Try to keep together two words. They looks like very distant, but I think we are able to match that distance.
Thank you. First, it's a pleasure to have you with us. And secondly, I have to say thank you for this presentation because it was breathtaking. I have to say, all these designs, all these projects show how much goes into your projects. It's the expertise, the technology, but also the heart and the social awareness. There's a combination of all these elements. And when I was looking at the photos, I thought, wow, what can creativity do? It's amazing. So thank you very much for that. At a certain point in your presentation, you said, we need to design better buildings. And that showed a lot about the way you see architecture. So we have a couple of questions from the audience, and one of them actually is connected to this. It's about workspaces in the future, now that we have this COVID experience. So the question is, how do you think architecture and workspaces will change after this? What do you think?
Well, it's a big discussion also in Italy, you know, after this dramatic moment, you know, a lot of companies, they rethinking to organize their space, because maybe in the last, I'm say 10 or 15 years, we design building to make a lot of people working together. It's like the density was a financial thing. So we need to put a lot of people in a small, in less square meters. So that's, of course, was not good. I think before the COVID, it was, in any case, necessary rethinking this relation between the working space and people for the better of the people. So I think after the COVID, many companies thinking, maybe I need to find another way. Maybe we need more space and less people. Maybe we need to create a more informal space. Maybe the fact that people can work from home, maybe not all the time, but a part of the time, we need to reduce our need of square meter and improving the quality of the space, maybe more for the relationship, for meeting people and discussing than back home. So I think, I'm not sure what will be the last solution, but the COVID, a part of the drama of the COVID, I think opened some area of rethinking about what does it mean go to work. And I think this is a good thing, because we're discovering that a lot of people can work from home. Then also we discovered that maybe the home we designed, they are not good for that. So, and we know that before, that many residential buildings are not good. They're not good quality. No? So if you want to live at home and working, you need a quality space. You need a comfort home. So maybe this period is make some point about what we are designing until today. No? Maybe we need to rethink it. And I see many, many companies to say, maybe we don't need any more 100,000 square meters. We need less, with less people, more connected, but with much more informal space for make people happy at work. And I think the happiness has come out after the COVID to say, we want to go work in an happy space to be happy. And I'm happy, I'm comfortable, I work better, and my life is better. So the COVID, post-COVID, thinking is maybe we need to find another way to live in better, no? Our single life at home, in the office, in the city, too much pollution. So why we need to live in a city where it's too much pollution? Why we need to reduce that pollution to live in better? And I think the European Commission work in this idea of 2030, 2050 is not only to reduce the emission for many reasons, which is too much, is too complicated to explain now, to reduce the relation with oil and gas, but mainly because we want to live better in our cities, in our buildings, in our schools. So I think that is the key point for answering your question.
Yes, thank you. So sure, as a creator, you saw this need even before the pandemic. It was something that you were already thinking about, being happy in the workplace and mental health and living comfortably. So that's very interesting. Thank you. The second question is about actually something totally different. You are an internationally renowned architect, but you're Italian. So what difference does that make, you know, when you meet other architects from other places of the world, other countries? What difference does being Italian make for you?
Well, I like to say then I'm not a global architect. I have Italian roots very deep, and I like to say that. You know, I think it's important, huh? Because we have an amazing story. We have maestri fantastic than nobody had it before. You know? So, like, I'm thinking about Carlo Scarpa, many architects who make the history of architecture with a thinking like relation between modern and history is typical Italian. You need to have this sensibility because we live in a so beautiful city, and not all people or architects live in a beautiful city like in Italy, you know? So we developing this relation with beauty, you know? And I think this is a quality, you know? It's something that I think we need to say more strongly, you know? I'm Italian, I'm happy, I can say in English, I like to say I'm Italian because I have deep roots. Then I'm work globally, of course, I'm part of the game. But these roots for me is about the holistic point of view of architecture. No, we need to think in a very large perspective. It's not about technological solution. Architecture is also technological solution, but it's about the vision. So we built the most beautiful city in the world. I'm not saying that myself. I know by the history. No? We say beauty is a one fundamental part of our life, and we did, because when we design in the past the city, one of the key points was to design better than the others. So when people make one buildings in the historical center, the others families say, oh, I want to do better than them. And the other ones, oh, I'm going to do better than them. And with this sort of a competition of beauty, we designed an amazing place. No? If you think about the church, no? It was a competition between architects to make the best. So I think all this creating a culture of beauty, which is not, I don't want to be wrong, you know, it's not an aesthetic thing. It's not only an aesthetic thing. It's about the ethic. It's about the idea that people need the beauty, you know, and these architects are the tools to make this thing beauty. So I like to say, I'm not sure that Italian are the best, that's for sure. That's not the point, you know. But the difference is different from American architects. The point of view is completely different of some North European. Maybe they are much more open than the Italians. We are maybe more strongly in this difficult relation with history, but there's something I deeply like is my maestro was Renzo Piano, and I worked with him for many years. And his maestro was Albini, was another amazing architect. And all the history of the last century was made by architect. They was able to have a technical vision, but in the same time, an humanistic vision. So I'm between two lines. Now, one, make building, you need to know the technology. You need to know how building stand up. Then you need to know a lot of things. But on the other hand, is the humanistic vision of our time make the difference? No? And that I think, is in Italian roots.
So this inborn relationship with beauty that you said brings to the competition of beauty, I like that. It doesn't get more Italian than that, the competition for beauty.
Yeah. Really, you know, Italian. It's an amazing story. You know, market in the square, no? The market in the square, there's many, no? But in the middle age, you know, was the engine of innovation. Why Italy, you know, is still one of the countries where there's a lot of invention and innovation? Because in the past, the people was using the market, you know, as a competition place. You know, the guy make a beautiful object, and then the next guy look at him, say, "Oh, I can do better than him," and he do it, you know, and he did. And then another guy say, "Oh, he did good. That's nice, but if I put myself there, I can do better." You know? And this is an engine, you know, because I can do better because I think I'm better. I mean, if you know the story in the end, we are the best car in the world. It's the best. Not because it's combining beauty, technology, mechanics. And that's coming from a long story of people saying, I can do better than him. No? And this looks like, you know, maybe it's the bad character of people. But in the other hand, it's moving a lot because people want to compete to do better. But competition to make better things is beautiful.
Yes, competing for beauty. That's very interesting. Thank you so much. And talking about beauty and the future, what are you currently working on or thinking of?
Well, we are busy in many, many buildings and projects. But I'm working now in one project which I'm deeply concerned about. This is a museum, no? It's an archaeological museum. It's a collection. It's a private collection of Etrurian art, vase of the 50th century before Christ, 5th century, no? So the question was on the table was how we can design an archaeological museum, because archaeological museum, they are very boring, no? You go inside, you see many vases. After a while, you say, "Wow, I can see 400 vases, you know, because I know the history so deeply," or after a while it's difficult. So the challenge was design of a museum to tell a story about a civilization. So you go inside, not only for watching the vase, but understand how people for 900 years is the history of Etruria, no? They was able to increase their quality of art production. So great, you know, from very basic to very sophisticated. No? And you go inside the museum and the space of museum tell your story. The architecture tell your story before to see the vase. So I like the idea that maybe the museum, like this one, is a museum. It's an emotion of space. You go inside, it's an underground museum, all designed in stones. And then you get the feeling to get really underground, you know, and the stone is around you, is a beautifully designed, is a super beautiful detail. So, and then you discover this glass box with this vase, but already you engage, your emotion already engaged, and then maybe you start to be passionate about the archaeological visit, you know. And I'm very, very happy. It will be open in December, so we'll be in Milan. So it's called Museo Rovati, is a foundation, which will be public, open to the public. And that will be a great experience. It's the first time that an archaeological museum become so excited. So I'm very happy.
Yes, thank you. I mean, it doesn't really, when you talk about an archaeological museum, you don't really connect emotion. So that will be very interesting to see. And maybe it will be nice to have another presentation on this in the future. So it would be very nice to talk to you a few hours. But, you know, thank you for being with us today. Thanks a lot for this inspiring presentation and talk. Thanks a lot.
Okay. Thank you very
All
much.
The best. Thank you.
Very
much. Thank you. After this very inspiring conversation with Mario Cucinella, let's talk about architecture and design from a different perspective. Our next guest speaker is Maria Grazia Mattei, founder and president of MEET, the Italian Center for Digital Culture, based in Milan. Mattei is a journalist, an art critic, and a curator. She was born in Pisa and has been living in Milan for more than 40 years. In 2005, she designed and launched MEET the Media Guru, a platform aiming at promoting the public dissemination of innovation and digital culture towards a non-professional audience. Since the late 80s, Mattei has championed cultural and professional exchanges between Italy and North America, with particular reference to the innovation of creative industries. In 2017, Mattei was awarded the Canada-Italy Innovation Award by the Embassy of Canada to Italy. and she is with us today to talk about meat. Enjoy the lecture.
Salve, sono molto molto felice di trovarmi qui con voi e ringrazio la Camera di Commercio Italiana di Toronto per questa opportunità che ha creato per dare un'idea, un'immagine di un'Italia che non è così consueta, non è così conosciuta. Io ho creato un progetto molto speciale di cui adesso vi parlerò. Mi occupo di mondi digitali dagli inizi degli anni Ottanta e l'Italia che vi voglio raccontare è un'Italia innovativa, fatta di creatori, di creativi, artisti, digitali, perché questo è il tema, e anche di uno spazio molto particolare che si chiama Meet, incontro. Meet, parto da questo, Meet è un progetto speciale nato qui a Milano, nel cuore di Milano, nato col supporto di Fondazione Cariplo. Fondazione Cariplo è una delle più grandi fondazioni filantropiche in Europa, in Italia di sicuro la principale, e con Fondazione Cariplo più o meno tre, quattro anni fa, abbiamo pensato che fosse arrivato il momento di creare qualcosa di veramente nuovo, innovativo, anche dal punto di vista architettonico qui a Milano, per affrontare un tema di cui oggi siamo tutti molto consapevoli. L'impatto delle tecnologie digitali nella nostra vita è un impatto che sta modificando tutti i nostri stili di vita, il nostro lavoro, la nostra modalità di comunicazione, di relazione con gli altri. L'abbiamo visto purtroppo in questo periodo che ci ha costretti in lockdown a comunicare in una maniera diversa, ma che ha delle grandissime comunque potenzialità. Il digitale come risorsa di innovazione e soprattutto il digitale culturale, perché Meet mette l'accento, è nato per dire una cosa: esiste una traiettoria innovativa digitale che prima ancora di essere tecnologica, oggi è culturale. Quindi dobbiamo, per essere dei cittadini consapevoli, appropriarci di questa dimensione, entrare dentro questa dimensione. Vedete, scorrono delle immagini del Meet. È una dimensione Meet che cerca di interpretare anche con il suo edificio, che è stato realizzato e costruito grazie, ripeto, al supporto di Fondazione Cariplo. Beh, questo edificio è nel pieno centro di Milano. È stato completamente ristrutturato con la collaborazione di Carlo Ratti, che lavora a Meet di Boston, quindi Meet Boston, Meet a Milano, è un gioco di parole, di suoni. È un edificio che già esisteva come spazio della cultura, dedicato alla cultura. Noi l'abbiamo, pur essendo un edificio dei primi del Novecento, piegato ad essere un ambiente fisico e virtuale al tempo stesso, una sorta di organismo che vive in maniera fluida, che vive in connettività, che permette le relazioni e le idee di scorrere al proprio interno come se fosse un media, un grande spazio, non voglio usare la parola televisiva, ma uno spazio mediatico comunicativo, e al tempo stesso permette collegamenti, connessioni, versatilità, immersione. Ecco, una delle parole chiave del Meet è proprio la parola immersione. Vedete, qui scorrono relatori, artisti, perché Meet che cosa fa? Meet organizza una serie di eventi che vanno a creare, con supporto di relatori, di artisti, di personaggi anche delle istituzioni, un ragionamento, una riflessione proprio sulla nostra epoca, sul cambiamento fondamentale nella nostra epoca. In questo momento l'avete visto, una sala immersiva dove scorrono le opere di Refik Anadol, che è un artista turco che vive a Los Angeles, che ha regalato un'opera meravigliosa a Milano titolata Renaissance Dream, quindi nel Rinascimento passato ci sono le tracce, la memoria, il DNA di tutto un progetto innovativo. Tornando all'ambiente Meet come architettura, come nuovo spazio, veramente Meet sta segnando una svolta anche nel concept dei nuovi spazi culturali. Non è un museo, non è neanche un centro culturale di classica concezione, perché, ripeto, è un organismo in grado di comunicare al proprio interno, di essere fisico e virtuale al tempo stesso, Diela, quindi di connettersi verso l'esterno e di essere, in una parola sola per usare un neologismo, figital. Dentro MIT porteremo ovviamente la dimensione di MIT e porteremo il mondo, perché la dimensione di MIT è internazionale. MIT nasce da un lungo programma di incontri che si chiamava Meet the Media Guru, e Meet the Media Guru era un format che ho creato a Milano nel 2005 e che ancora va avanti, adesso è diventato uno dei pilastri del MIT, che ha portato qui sulla scena di Milano personaggi di fama internazionale, mondiale, come John Lasseter o Francis Ford Coppola per il cinema digitale, filosofi come Bauman, sociologi come Edgar Morin, ma anche Joe Ito, che ha diretto e è stato presidente del MIT di Boston. Insomma, abbiamo creato veramente un dibattito continuo. Questo è un segnale molto forte di un'Italia che sa essere anche innovativa. E a questo proposito diciamo che MIT mette al proprio centro la creatività. La creatività, se non addirittura l'arte, perché l'arte, e lo dice anche la nostra Europa, la Commissione Europea, è una sorta di enzima che aiuta a intercettare il futuro, a elaborare nuove piste di culturali, espressive, per poter comprendere la complessità dell'epoca in cui viviamo, e l'arte poi introdotta e portata all'interno anche di spazi economici, industriali, aziendali, genera dei fermenti, un fermento straordinario di innovazione. Il punto di vista del MIT è che non c'è innovazione se non c'è consapevolezza e se soprattutto non c'è un lavoro, un cambiamento mentale, culturale quindi, che ci porti ad essere non passivi utilizzatori di tecnologie, ma attivi utilizzatori, protagonisti dell'epoca che stiamo vivendo. Dobbiamo uscire da una dimensione tecnocentrica per entrare in una dimensione dove ciascuno di noi è padrone dei mezzi che usa e li può utilizzare spingendoli sempre più avanti. Quello che state vedendo è una panoramica di artisti italiani con i quali abbiamo inaugurato come MIT un progetto molto bello a Malpensa, che ora ha riaperto finalmente il suo traffico aereo e che riprenderà quota come prima. Come vedrete, un grandissimo schermo lungo 12 metri è stato messo a disposizione di MIT. MIT ha chiamato una serie di artisti, quelli che state vedendo sono un gruppo italiano che si chiama Fuse, che elaborano che cosa? Loro sono in grado di lavorare con sistemi di intelligenza artificiale, arte generativa, e hanno dato in questa maniera il benvenuto, stanno dando il benvenuto a tutti voi che speriamo di vedervi passare anche dal nostro aeroporto principale, da Malpensa appunto a Milano, danno un benvenuto con una Milano che si racconta in una maniera nuova. Quella che vedete è una Milano che si rappresenta attraverso i sentiment delle persone, i messaggi, una parola sola, i dati che ognuno di noi lascia quando visita una città, quando fa una foto, quando manda un commento, quando scrive dei messaggi. Ecco, noi con quattro artisti, Fuse, ma anche Carlo Stanga che vedete tra poco, eccetera, abbiamo voluto con un linguaggio innovativo presentare non solo Milano innovativa, ma tutto sommato un'Italia innovativa. Dico questo a proposito di innovazione e digitale. Si è sempre detto molto poco di questa nostra Italia così nuova, aperta a tutte le dimensioni espressive, comunicative, progettuali, ma anche produttive, perché il digitale entra anche nei flussi di produzione di un'azienda. Ecco, abbiamo detto sempre poco, ma questa è una gran bella occasione per dire: guardate, noi abbiamo un DNA creativo, l'ha detto Refika Nadol con Renaissance Dream, ma abbiamo anche un DNA creativo che ci permette di spingere avanti la nostra immaginazione e accogliervi, come in questo caso, con delle produzioni creative assolutamente innovative e all'altezza di produzioni, grandi produzioni internazionali. Quindi io spero di avervi incoraggiato a tornare a visitarci anche con questo spirito di scoperta di un'Italia che non è solo soltanto, diciamo, industriale tecnico, ma è un paese la cui cultura passata si innesta sulle traiettorie contemporanee, e la contemporaneità, l'innovazione attuale di linguaggi, eccetera, ha le sue basi in un DNA straordinario che risale alle epoche storiche che questo paese ha attraversato. Ora si tratta di scoprire questo nuovo rinascimento, si tratta di raccontarvi questo nuovo rinascimento, e come questi quattro artisti di cui vi ho parlato, Carlo Stanga, Luzzana, i Fuse, altri autori, String Color, altri autori, altri artisti sono presenti nel nostro paese, pronti a raccontare in maniera diversa, completamente in sintonia e sintonizzato, ripeto, con altri grandi progetti che esistono al mondo. Quindi benvenuti, oppure come recita il nostro progetto artistico a Malpensa, nice to meet you.
Grazie, that was an amazing lecture on, like you said, a special, special project, and it really is. Thank you for shining a digital light on Italy. I never heard anything like this before, so, you know, the Renaissance dream, and especially the fact that you said that there is no innovation without awareness. That's a great message, mixing the two worlds. Thank you so much. I have a couple of questions from the audience. And the first one is, July 8th is Italian Design Day. And this year's theme is Project and Materials, the Sustainable Recovery of Made in Italy. What does sustainable recovery mean to you?
Per me è possibile pensare assolutamente a una ripresa che faccia leva nel nostro paese in particolare, ma in relazione col mondo, che faccia leva sulla creatività, che è sempre stato un segno distintivo del nostro progettare, produrre, che sia architettura, design, moda, arte. E il tema della sostenibilità è però importante, perché in ogni nostra progettualità oggi dobbiamo tenere presente e considerare assolutamente il tema della questione ambientale, che significa anche avere un approccio non solo culturale ma anche economico, produttivo, a questa nuova dimensione assolutamente necessaria, che venga disegnata adesso, che venga affrontata, che diventi un capitale con il quale fare i conti dal punto di vista anche, ripeto, economico e produttivo.
Thank you. You mentioned architecture and spaces, and there is actually another question about spaces coming from, you know, after the pandemic. How do you think the concept of spaces changed over the past year?
Non c'è dubbio che siamo entrati in una fase dove si sono già cominciati a modellare nuove forme, nuovi sistemi. Faccio un esempio relativo, per esempio, al lavoro. Non si torna a modelli vecchi di gestione che prevedevano sempre soltanto la presenza fisica, per quanto importante, ma tutta la dimensione diciamo virtuale, e quindi la connessione, lo smart working, eccetera, saranno una parte, una componente che va a ridisegnare un modello di team organizzativo nuovo. Noi dobbiamo fare i conti con questo nuovo, in cui abbiamo cominciato a intravedere delle grandi potenzialità e che va ancora esplorato. Per quanto riguarda gli spazi, io sono molto contenta che MIT, già 7 anni fa, abbia pensato a uno spazio che fosse un organismo che viveva tra reale e virtuale. Oggi c'è bisogno che questi spazi nostri siano connessi e che permettano con grande facilità connettività e flessibilità, e poi, quando sono spazi artistici o comunicativi, anche un'immersione in nuove forme narrative. Quindi oggi concepire anche solo un'abitazione senza pensare alle sue infrastrutture tecnologiche avanzate in modo da guardare avanti sarebbe un errore gravissimo. Detto banalmente, uno spazio fisico oggi non solo deve avere la luce e l'acqua, come sempre è stato negli ultimi, ovviamente dal dopoguerra in poi in Italia, eccetera, perché c'è stato un periodo dove non c'era neanche la luce e l'acqua nelle abitazioni, ma deve avere anche questa infrastruttura in maniera invisibile, chiamiamola telematica, chiamiamola di connettività, ma deve esserci questo sistema nervoso nelle case o nelle abitazioni, ma anche nei luoghi di lavoro, che ti permettono di essere fisico e virtuale.
Thank you, and you said it before, phygital. I mean, you were definitely a pioneer in this field, and now you really know what you're talking about. Thank you so much, Maria Grazia, for your contribution and your insights today. Thank you for your lecture. Thanks a lot.
Grazie a voi.
Thank you, Maria Grazia Mattei, and thank you, Mario Cucinella, for your beautiful presentations. And now, just a minute for a video on the event online booklet. You will find also the link in your chat. Thank you. Thank you once again to Sistema Italia for their incredible support. I'd like to remind to all of you that this is the 60th anniversary of ICO Canada. Please stay around, become a member. And I would like also to take this opportunity to inform you that the Istituto Italiano di Cultura is offering a variety of Italian language and culture courses, ranging from beginner to advanced levels. Please contact the Istituto to register for these lessons. And now, allow me to thank all the people who work incredibly hard behind the scenes, both before and during the event. Thank you, Mary Chirico, Ilaria Venoso, Monica Gammarota, Richard Bressan, Tiziana, Astrid, Marisa. Thank you all. We're going to be together on July the 15th with the lesson dedicated to culture and tourism. Thank you.